thank Honorable Ajit Kaur Ji for inviting me to this East Asian Literature Festival and friends. The marvelous political promise which the term SARC held out for us some decades ago may or may not have been realized. But I will say this, the term is crucial for us literary and cultural thinkers, historians and creative writers. A collective identity that we from South Asia forged together in this vision of oneness has facilitated a new way of understanding of our literatures and cultures. We are sibling countries, Bangladesh, Bhutan, India, Maldives, Nepal, Pakistan, Sri Lanka and Afghanistan. Because we have many commonalities as well as diversity in our cultural ethos, literary tradition and historical parts. In the 19th century, at the high point of colonialism, there were some new developments. At this time, the West began to get interested in what we termed world culture. The problematic nature of this concept becomes apparent when we see how this umbrella term world culture tries to homogenize all the non-Western cultures. Besides, this idea of world culture seems to be based on a model where the West is at the center and all the non-Western cultures are placed in marginal and peripheral positions. The SARC identity also becomes important in resisting such sidelining of the non-Western lands and cultures. Many of our post-colonial nations in South Asia asserted their distinct political and cultural identities by forming this collective in the 80s. Today, once again our South Asian cultures face a similar threat of marginalization by the West. In our globalized world today, there is the fear of the consumer economy and Coca-Colonization engulfing our society. This development might result in our cultures and histories getting subsumed in the hegemonic history of globalization and its political, economic and cultural impact. It is in this context that the reassertion of our South Asianness becomes imperative. Therefore, in this workshop today, we must begin by asking some crucial questions about South Asian cultures and literatures. My specific subject and theme is SARC poetry. This theme is connected with some crucial cultural questions. What makes South Asian poetry different from that of the West? As we are all aware of by now, because of our colonial parts, the European and American literary models and templates have been forced on us in the name of modernity. Such models fail to express the plural social, political and cultural experiences of our South Asian worlds. How can we voice the material histories of suppression and resistance that many of our South Asian countries have been through with such borrowed models? Should not we start challenging the blind incorporation of these alien and alienating models in our literature? How do we establish this idea of SARC poetry in the international and global context? These are some of the questions and issues we must bring up in this workshop, I suppose. As I mentioned earlier, this concept of the South Asian collective suggests a rich cultural and literary repertoire of shared traditions, social ethos, political and historical experiences, literary styles and even languages. Therefore, I will discuss this idea of SARC poetry with the example nearest to me, the Indian one, or rather that of the Indian subcontinent. When I mention the subcontinent, naturally I am keenly aware of the multiplicity and diversity that characterize this poetry of the subcontinent. Besides, we also took the English language and English culture from the colonizer and made it our own. This has been a double-edged legacy for us. While it is mostly Indian English writing that reaches readers across the world, writing in our Indian languages tend to be neglected. Therefore, when we talk of Sar poetry, we must also look at such regional and indigenous literatures of South Asia. The next question, what binds our South Asian literatures together? My answer would be, we are known for our storytelling. As a writer who draws his inspiration from the folk culture of North Karnataka, I am aware of the long and ancient tradition of storytelling in our society. Beginning from the epics to even the recent genres like the novel, it is this aspect that stands out. In addition, the cultural ethos of South Asia strongly uphold the community bonds. Take the case of Kannada writing for instance. Not only the orator, even written literature privileges this aspect of our life and thinking. Look at the Vachana literature in the 12th century or later Dasa Sahitya. The Bhakti movement all over India, in fact, focused on addressing the God directly, speaking to this God, or holding a dialogue with him. This literature emerged out of the devotional community and sought to describe even the relationship with God in terms of human bonds. This is very different from the Navya sensibility which we derived from 20th century European modernism, both in Indian English writing and literature in Indian languages. This European modernism privileges the individual and turns away from society and community bonds. However, despite the strong influence of European modernism, Indian writers did not move away completely from the older native and indigenous traditions. My own writing has been nourished by oral and folk traditions of my place. What is more, our native traditions were also nurtured by popular culture, beginning from traditional forms like Yakshagana and Harikatha to contemporary cinema. Interestingly, Indian postmodernist writers like, for example, Salman Rushdie or Amitav Ghosh have famously floated Western realism dipped into film culture, drawn upon pan-Indian as well as local mythologies. They question the colonial and neo-colonial forces that invade this subcontinent, its cultures and its literatures. I would like to end my talk with a few other random thoughts. How should Sar culture resist the onslaught of these neo-colonial forces? What kind of dialogue should we facilitate among the Sar cultures today? No doubt, translation will play an important role in bridging the linguistic gaps among us. The certainty of the act of translation must make us pay more attention to the availability and quality of such interlingual translations of South Asian literatures. The Academy, like always, is seriously committed to this task. Meanwhile, I thank you for giving me this great opportunity to address you all on this occasion of the Sar Literary Festival. Poets from many parts of the South Asia have gathered here. I hope to be part of the main discussions, debates and exchange of ideas that are going to take place. I look forward to exploring issues like writing, culture and identity in relation to the South Asian literary world. Thank you very much.